few days ago I mentioned the subject of the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam being ma'soom, free from sin. And I mentioned the Ash'ari position and the ulama who highlighted the Ash'ari position in their works. For more detail, for instance, you can find in the Zarasail Al-Masail Al-Khilafiyya Bain Al-Ash'a'ira Wal-Maturidiyya, showing the differences between the Ash'ari school and the Maturidi school, highlighting the meaning of Ismatul Anbiya. And I just wanted to highlight this at the beginning because this topic is brought up many times. And the work that I mentioned that day, the one written by Abu al-Hasan Ali bin Ahmad al-Sibti al-Umawi, known as Ibn Khumayr rahimahullah ta'ala, and from the 7th century of Damascus, he wrote a book called Tanzihul al-Anbiya amma nasaba ilayhim huthalatul al-Aghbiya, regarding this issue of attributing sin to Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam and misunderstanding verses of Al-Qur'an al-Kareem. He covers each Prophet and Messenger alayhimu salatu wassalam, starting with Sayyiduna Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. Any verses which people may misinterpret, he gives the correct interpretation, and ending with the Khatamun Nabiyyin, Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. I thought this was important to mention at the beginning because the first group that started attributing sin to Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam was the Yahud. And the Yahud, la'anahumullah, they had the habit of insulting the Prophets alayhimu salatu wassalam, and this habit continues today, where we have comedy sketches of Sayyiduna Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, or even Sayyiduna Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, and they have attempted to do the same with our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And this is a global agenda. This agenda fits in with the secular outlook on the modern world. And some have decided to call this the New World Order, or the New Order and the New World. The way they look at religion is as something which is from the khurafat, something which is made up and not true. So in order to make people think low of religion, they attack the figurehead of that religion. And the figurehead of Al-Islam is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. This happens from the outside, and we know, as I will mention later, what a Shaykh Yusuf al-Nabahani rahimahullah ta'ala says in his work Sabilun Najati fil Hubbi fil Allah wal Bughdi fil Allah, regarding the kuffar, the disbelievers, that they being our enemies, and the kuffar are our enemies. Not sugarcoating our words in accordance Inshallah. With the political climate. Inshallah. If people have taken over Al-Quds al-Sharif and are killing Muslims, and have taken over Al-Iraq and Afghanistan and are killing Muslims in their thousands, they are our enemies. But the danger is when the enemy is within. And even more dangerous is when people have hid themselves with the celebration of the Mawlid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Now the Mawlid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is being employed for political gains. We have seen in the past 5 years, the Mawlid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is celebrated and commemorated by people who have heavy funds booking stadiums, and they have changed the agenda of the Mawlid to a political agenda. And this is more dangerous. And then they have moved from the Mawlid to mentioning in every Mawlid and Dalailul Khairat gatherings that the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, if he does not intend insult, then that is not an insult. This is to fit in with the agenda of many groups, like I always mention the radical middle way and groups that are similar to the radical middle way. And this would fall true even for people who call themselves Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah, because How do you differentiate between a sectarian person and a person who is standing up for a principle? There is a clear difference between someone who is standing up for a principle and someone who is sectarian. For instance, you will get many people who will ascribe themselves to the Barelvi school of thought, and they will say they are Barelvi and they ascribe themselves to Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala. So because of this, they will boycott Deobandis, and rightly so. But when someone else insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, they will mix with him. These people are sectarian because they are not looking at principle. The principle of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala was nothing personal against the school of Deoband. It was based on a principle that anyone who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam must be ostracized. And if there is a Khalifa or a Sultan who implements the Sharia, he must be killed. So it does not make sense when we have people who ascribe themselves to Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala and say that they ostracize the Deobandi school, but yet they involve themselves with other insulters of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. For instance, the case that happened with Ahmad Hassoun, and we know Ahmad Hassoun, the so-called Mufti of Syria, and we know in reality the real Mufti of Syria is a Shaykh Abdul Razzaq hafizahullah ta'ala, but he is the government Hassoun. Ahmad Hassoun is the government appointed Mufti of that country, and he made insulting remarks regarding the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam nearly 1 year ago. But yet certain people who claimed to follow Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala did not stand up for that principle because of politics and government funding or whatever ties they have with people who are shady, or what we say dodgy. People who are not straight and are not following the principle of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. But I would like to point out that the manhaj, the methodology of Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala, and the Shaykh Badruddin Al-Hassani rahimahullah ta'ala, and the Shaykh Yusuf Al-Nabahani rahimahullah ta'ala, was not based on sectarianism, but it was based on the principle that the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is a disbeliever, a kafir, a murtad, an apostate. But you will find people now saying that we need to revise the law, the medieval law of the murtad, the apostate. Those same people who are calling for a revision of the Murtad law have good ties also with the perennialists. The perennialists, the people who believe in unity of all religion. And an example of those is this publishing house, Funds Vitae. They have hijacked the books of Tasawwuf, the books of Tasawwuf, and they publish valid works. Like for instance, this work, Abu Abdul Rahman As-Sulimi rahmallahu ta'ala. Look at the work, it is a small pamphlet. Even the typeset is huge. And the work is only a small pamphlet. If you buy this in Al-Maghrib al-Sharif or in Al-Sham al-Sharif, we Pakistanis have a tendency to call everything associated with awliya and the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam as Sharif. The reason I say Al-Maghrib al-Sharif is because the awlad of Mawla Idris is the awlad of Sayyidina Imam al-Hasan radiallahu ta'ala an. And we know the Maghariba are strong people when it comes to standing up for defense of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, like the A'ilatul Kattaniyin, A'ilatul Ya'qubiyin, and other blessed families from the Maghrib. So this pamphlet, they translated, and maybe they will price this for £30 for the middle class, middle to upper class audience who they are targeting. And some people, a particular individual who wrote his Q News article, mentioned that we must thank the perennialist community for their contributions to Islam. But let's look at these contributions. This particular book, if we look at this particular book, you'll find something that those scholars who are associating themselves with Funds Vitae are advisors to Funds Vitae. And this book was published in the year 2006. How many years ago? 5 years ago. And We find, for instance, things like this. The Prophet in the Garden of Paradise, and they have a picture of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam according to their claims. According to their claims. And then we turn to the Lot tree of the boundary, and they say, Na'udhu billah, wal'iyadhu billah. They are saying that this is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Buraq. Then Moses and Muhammad talking, wal'iyadhu billah. This is Funds Vitae. Go on their website and look at the advisory board of this group, and you will find the agenda to make this form of al-Islam acceptable in the West. And they refer to our outlook, which is based on the four schools, as the immigrant outlook. Some people refer to it as the immigrant outlook. The immigrant people, are you an immigrant? Most of us are born here. But our outlook is based on al-madhahib al-arba'a and the ijma'. Then look, Gabriel in his true form, wal-iyadhu billah. So you get the idea, this book is like this, and the advisory board for this consists of people who celebrate the maulid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and call for a revision of what they call medieval laws. Now people associated with that same group of people have written articles, like the American researcher who wrote a work called Iman, Kufr and Takfir. And he wrote this work to correct Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala, even though he himself claims to have done suluk at the hand of a valid Shaykh. And therefore his muridun, his followers, consider him almost sinless, that he is incapable of making a mistake in this research, and he is capable of correcting the earlier ulama in the fatwa that they gave. So I brought with me Lawaqihul Anwar al-Qudsiya fi Biyan al-Uhud al-Muhammadiyya sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam of Sayyidi Abdul Wahab bin Ahmad bin Ali al-Sha'rani al-Hanafi al-Misri rahimahullahu ta'ala, passed away in the year 973. A very beneficial author, the author of Al-Anwar al-Qudsiya and other beneficial works like Tanbih al-Mukhtarin and his work Al-Mizan al-Kubra and other works which are very beneficial in their chapter. He mentions in this work, the first chapter consists of those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a covenant from the believers that they must carry out, the ma'murat. And the second chapter deals with manhiyat, those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. And I wanted to start with this chapter. He mentions, أَخَذَ عَلَيْنَا الْأَهْدَ الْعَامَ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمُ أَلَّا نَتَدَيَّنَ بِفَعْلِ شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْبِدْعِ الْمَذْمُومَةِ الَّتِي لَا يَشَدُ لَهَا ظَاهِرُ كِتَابٍ وَلَا سُنَّةٍ وَأَنْ نَجْتَلِبَ الْعَمَلَ بِكُلِّ رَأْيٍ لَمْ يَظْهَرْ لَنَا وَجْهُ مُوَافَقَتِهِ لِلْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ إِلَّا إِنْ أُجْمِعَ عَلَيْهِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken from us a covenant that we do not take as religion any action from the innovations, the reprehensible innovations, which there is no corroboration from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, unless there is ijma' on that subject. And we do not make our own opinions. But yet we will find that this group of people who are disguising themselves with the Mawlid and the Dala'ilul Khairat are presenting their own opinions over the verdicts of the ulama. And in some places, opposing the ijma' of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. But what he says further down is even more interesting. He gives nasiha, advice, and I give this nasiha to myself first and everyone else, but those disciples of this American researcher should know that if someone has done suluk with a valid Shaykh, it does not mean that he can slip, he cannot slip on any one given issue. He can slip. And Al-Imam Abdul Wahhab al-Sha'rani rahmullah ta'ala mentions the reasons and causes of that slip. He says, فَطَالِعْ يَا أَخِي كُتُبَ أَهْلِ السُنَّةِ الْمُحَمَّدِيَةِ, that research and look, do mutala'a of the works of Ahl al-Sunnah and وَكُتُبَ عُلَمَائِهَا وَكُتُبَ الْأُصُولِيِّينَ, that look at the works of the scholars of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah and the works of the scholars of principles, usuliyin, and warasail al-sufiyya, and the epistles of the sufiyya, meaning the people of tasawwuf. Walau salakta tariqa ala yadi shaykhin, even if you have done suluk, you have traversed the path on the hand of a shaykh. Even if you have done this, then continue researching these books. But what does he say? Does he say, research these books yourself? No. He's telling the person who has finished his suluk, has finished his suluk on the hand of a valid shaykh, that go and study ala yadi shaykhin khawfan min an yazilla lisanuka bi shay'in min ulum ad-da'irah al-batina, that maybe your tongue will slip with regard to the inward sciences, the batin sciences. And then what will happen? Fayunkiruhu alayka al-ulama'u, and the ulama will reject this from you. فَيَقِلُّ نَفْعُكَ لِلنَّاسِ, and your benefit for people will become less, meaning less people will benefit from you. And we have seen, we have saw the state of those people who have opposed the ulama, the awliya, al-saliqeen, and what has happened to them. Now, some of these disciples may say, you are opposing a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will say that you have not read this atrocious article known as Iman, Kufr and Takfir, and neither have you understood it. The author of that work opposes the awliya and opposes, in fact, the Messenger of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and ascribes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which he is free from, which we will come unto regarding the topic of Imkan al-Kadhib. So the author of this work used a work of Imam As-Subki rahmallahu ta'ala, Taqiyuddin As-Subki rahmallahu ta'ala, a scholar of the 7th century, in order to justify that anyone who does not intend insult of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, according to this author, he still remains a Muslim. And he used a quote from this work, As-Sayf al-Maslul, ala man sabba al-Rasul alayhi salatu wa salam, the unsheathed sword on the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. I mentioned this in a previous lecture, and here, this is the passage which he quoted, that Al-Imam al-Subki rahmallahu ta'ala says, after mentioning the punishment of the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which by the ijma', the agreement, the consensus of the ulama, is that in an Islamic state or where the Sharia is implemented, that person be killed. And if people are unable to carry out that had punishment, like we are incapable of carrying out that had punishment, then the Muslims must boycott such a person and consider him a disbeliever, like these people of Fons Vitae, these perennialist people, and other groups like Furyk in India. And Fons Vitae here, I've taken this to another stage where they have placed pictures of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa iyadu billah. And we have people on their advisory board still advising them. Allah knows best whether those people have advised them or not. If they have not, then I tell them they should advise them. And if they do not change their publications, in fact, you should not be on an advisory board for perennialists, for people who do not believe in al-Islam and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam in accordance with the shara'it of Iman. So in order to say that the person who does not intend insult, he does not commit kufr, the author of Iman, Kufr and Takfir quoted this passage, which Al-Imam Subki rahmallahu ta'ala says, فَإِن قُلْتَ قَدْ كَانَ مِن جُمْلَةِ مَنْ خَاضَ فِي الْإِفْكِ مِسْتَحٌ وَجَمَاعَةٌ مِنْ خِيَارِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِمَّنْ يُقْتَعُ بِأَنَّهُمْ لَا يُحْكَمُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِكُفْرٍ وَلَا قَتْلٍ وَلَوْ كَانَ مَا اسْتَدْلَلْتَ بِهِ عَلَى ظَاهِرِهِ لَوَجَبَ إِجْرَاءُ ذَلِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَكَانَ سَبُّ أَزْوَاجِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ مُوجِبًا لِلْكُفْرِ أَوْ لِلْقَتْلِ. The question arose after Al-Imam al-Subki mentioned the punishment for the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, that if you say that they must be killed, then what of those people who, when they accused Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha in Al-Ifk, and some of them were companions who did not do it out of nifaq, they done it because they were genuinely mistaken. So they were not given the death punishment. And he mentions Mistah and a group of the best of Muslims that they were not killed. Al-Imam al-Subki rahimahullah ta'ala in replying to this states, قُلْتُ الْأَذَى عَلَىٰ قِسْمَيْنِ أَذًى مَقْصُودٌ وَأَذًى غَيْرُ مَقْصُودٍ فَمِسْتَحٌ وَحَمْنَةُ وَحَسَّانُ لَمْ يَكُنْ مَقْصُودُهُمْ أَذَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَلِذَلِكَ لَا يَجْرَى عَلَيْهِمْ كُفْرٌ وَلَا قَتْلٌ وَأَمَّا ابْنُ أُبَيٍّ فَكَانَ مَقْصُودُهُ بِالْأَذَى النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَلِذَلِكَ يَسْتَحِقُّ الْقَتْلَ وَلَكِنَّ الْحَقَّ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَلَهُ تَرْكُهُ. He mentions two things. He says that harming the Messenger صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم is two types. One is when someone intends, and one is when someone does not intend. But the author of Iman Kufr Takfir took this passage to say that this applies in today's day and age on anyone who does not intend, when the context of why Al-Imam al-Subki is quoting this is the Mas'alatul Ifk, the accusation of Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And the Ifk was made by who? Al-Munafiqoon. Even Al-Imam al-Subki rahmallahu ta'ala states this on the next page, when he says, فَهَؤُلَاءِ مِنْ خِيَارِ السَّحَابَةِ لَمْ يَقْصِدُوا الْأَذَى فَلِذَلِكَ لَمْ يَتَرَتَّبْ عَلَيْهِمْ حُكْمُهُ وَأَمَّا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ أُبَيٍّ فَمَا حَمَلَهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ إِلَّا نِفَاقُهُ وَبُغْضُهُ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَقَصْدُهُ الْإِذَاءَ فَلِذَلِكَ كَانَ يستحق القتل إلا أن النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم حلم عليه. That those companions who mistakenly made that, they mistakenly accused Sayyidatuna Aisha رضي الله عنها, their intention was not to insult the Messenger صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. As for Abdullah bin Ubay, then he had nifaq. Now I want to ask you something. When the khilafah of Sayyidina Umar رضي الله عنه came about, what did Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu say regarding the rulings that we do not know the hearts of people and we will carry out the hudud on the outward? Who is the one who will know who is a munafiq and who is not a munafiq? The one who has been given the knowledge of the unseen. So Al-Imam al-Subki rahmallahu ta'ala is talking about a specific event that those companions did not intend to harm the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and therefore they were not punished, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam forgave them. He also mentions here, وَلَكِنَّ الْحَقَّ لِلنَّبِيِّ sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam فَلَهُ تَرْكُوهُ. The right of this is for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and he has the right to leave it, to leave anyone if they insult him. So those people whom the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam forgave in his lifetime, they were forgiven because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam forfeited his own right. And he was able to distinguish who is doing this with the intention of nifaq and who is doing this without the intention of nifaq, while now that no longer remains. And to substantiate this, you can look at your work, for instance, of Al-Imam Suyuti rahimahullah ta'ala, Al-Bahir fi hukm al-Nabiyyi bil-Batini wal-Zahir. This is discussing those rulings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which he knew of, and he knew the intentions of those people. Now, Al-Imam Badruddin Al-Hassani rahimahullah ta'ala, who was one of the revivers, mujaddideen of the previous century, and whose tajdeed continues, and was a great imam, and a lover of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, being of Al-Hassani lineage, from the Maghariba. He rahimahullah ta'ala has a fatwa on the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. This book was published recently, Al-Muhaddith Al-Akbar Shaykh Shiyukh Al-Sham, Al-Shaykh Muhammad Badruddin Al-Hassani rahimahullah ta'ala. When we were in Damascus, we would visit his grave on a regular basis, and we would visit his student, Al-Shaykh Ahmad Al-Habbal rahimahullah ta'ala wa nafa'ana Allah ta'ala bihi. And the Shaykh delivered many durus, lectures in Al-Jami' Bani Umayyah, the Umayyad Mosque. And one of the lectures which he delivered is the hukm on the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. This is his fatwa. It is found in this work on page 295. Darul Bayruti has published this. And Mahmoud Bayruti is the compiler. He has taken this fatwa from the written durus of Sheikh Badruddin Al-Hassani rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Imam Badruddin Al-Hassani rahimahullah ta'ala states, "Man istakhaffa bin Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam yuqtal. Wa la tuqbalu tawbatuhu kama huwa 'inda al-Imam Malik." Wa anna hadha haddun, that the one who makes light istakhaffa, meaning in making light of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, he states such a thing that he is diminishing the rank of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And we will come to statements of such a nature. He is killed and his repentance is not accepted according to Al-Imam Malik, even though there's a difference of opinion on that aspect, whether his repentance is accepted or not. The agreement is that such a person becomes a kafir. And the agreement is also on that he be killed. Al-Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala had a beautiful madhab. And the Malikiyya, a lovers of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, like Al-Imam Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, Al-Imam Muhammad bin Ja'far al-Kattani, Al-Imam Ja'far al-Kattani, who has a book in defense of the name of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which I forgot to bring with me, a beautiful book in defense of the honor of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So he states that ثم يورد رحمه الله تعالى شواهد من الأحاديث تعدد هذا الحكمة وتبينه. He mentioned a hadith pertaining to the insulting of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and he mentions a story. Listen to the story from the ahadith. فيذكر قصة المرأة التي كانت في أهد النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وتكلمت بكلمة في حقه عليه الصلاة والسلام. A woman spoke against the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Al-Shaykh Badruddin Al-Hassan is quoting this. فقال من لي بها أي من يذهب إليها ويقتلها. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who will deal with her? Meaning, Al-Shaykh Badruddin says, who will go to her and kill her? فذهب عميرة, a companion known as Umayra radiallahu anhu went and وكان أعمى. He radiallahu anhu had lost his sight. فجاء إليها وكانت من قبيلة خطمة وكانت ترضع طفلا. He went to her and she was from a tribe and she was breastfeeding a child. فذهب عميرة في الليل. This companion went in the night. وأخذ سيفه. He took out his sword. ونحى ابنها عنها. He took away her child from her. وقتلها, and he killed her. ثم جاء إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. He went to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم and he said, لا ينتطح فيها عن أذان فأرسلت مثلا. That the Messenger صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم said, two goats will not even butt their heads over her. And this became a method, meaning people would say this whenever something would happen, and in order to say that nothing will come of it, they would say, no two goats will butt their heads over it. So showing that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam at times forgave people, and at times had his right taken, and he avenged his right for the sake of Allah, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وذكر أيضا قصة كعب بن الأشرف الذي كان يهجو النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وكيف انتصر محمد بن مسلم للنبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وقتل عدو الله هذا. He mentioned other narrations, رحم الله. Now, he mentioned something which is very interesting toward the end, الشيخ بدر الدين الحسن. He says, وَلَوْ فُرِضَ أَنَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ كَانَ قَدْ وَقَعَ مِنْهُ تَرْكُ ذَلِكَ أي قتل من يسبه ويهجوه في حياته فليس لأمته من بعده أن يتساهلوا في ذلك لأن حقه عليه الصلاة والسلام إذا أسقطه في حياته كان له ذلك أما بعد مماته فلا يجوز التساهل به. Very important. He says, if we find examples that he left this right of his, then of those people who insulted him in his lifetime, then it is not for his nation after him. فَلَيْسَ لِأُمَّتِهِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ أَنْ يَتَسَاهَلُوا فِي ذَلِكَ, that they become easy on this. Why? Because it is his right which he has dropped at times in his lifetime. After his passing away, it is not allowed for people to become easygoing in this. It is not allowed for anyone to become easygoing in this. So those people who are using the maulid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam with wrong ends, they must take heed from this. And then, Shaykh Abdullah al-Ghumari rahmallahu ta'ala, arju billah that he may be forgiven rahmallah just for this work of his. السيف البتار لمن سب النبي المختار. He says on page 31 something very relevant to our situation in this modern world. Some people will not speak on this issue because they have involvement with political parties like Ikhwan al-Muslimin, or involvement with radical middle way, or involvement with or different governments, involvement with politicians or taking money. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best their intentions, and I am not attacking anyone's intentions. I am looking at the outward, that they are mistaken in saying that we should forgive people like Salman Rushdie, which someone has said. And he quoted abrogated verses which I mentioned in a previous talk. Abdullah al-Ghumari mentioned something which is very relevant. He says, ونأسف غاية الأسف على ذهاب الغيرة الإسلامية من قلوب المسلمين ومن وجدانهم ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. You know, we say in our Kashmiri language, غيرت. And in Arabic, they also have غيرة. How would you translate this word in English? Now, he says, with great regret, that the Islamic ghayra has gone from the hearts of the Muslims.
Self-respect
has gone from the hearts of the Muslims. But I would not even say self-respect. This is why I said, how would you translate it? I think it's almost non-translatable. Why? Because self-respect is relating to the self. Ghayra goes beyond the self. Ghayra goes beyond the self. Ghayra goes into ghayra for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ghayra for His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, ghayra for the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum. People who have ties with the Iranian regime will never speak up against those who insult Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, or against those who insult Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, or those who say regarding tahrif al-Quran. So Abdullah al-Ghumari rahimahullah, he pointed out here that this ghayra has not been found, and he wrote this after the Salman Rushdie affair. Now look what he says. وَقَدْ حَصَلَتْ حَادِثَةٌ مِّنْ هَذَا النَّوْعِ أظهر فيها مسلم من قوة الإيمان ما لا يوجد عند كبراء مسلمين وزعمائهم الذين يتصدرون المجالس ويتشدقون بالخطب الحماسية الجوفاء. He says that many events have happened and a Muslim who has strong Iman will show such strength of Iman which great Muslims and leaders cannot show, those who come out for gatherings and doing speeches, dry speeches. They come out. For instance, when the Danish cartoon thing happened, which started all this affair of, we after that, the Iman Kufr Takfir article was written in 2007. Around that time, certain perennial lists were made to look like major awliya. They wrote obituaries to people who were perennial lists when they were alive, and they want Muslims here to accept them as major awliya and make them saints after their passing away, even though they have perennialist beliefs. So this wave that has come with Mawlid, the facade of Mawlid, but the Mawlid containing a political message or government funding, this has come about, and then articles have been written where justification has been done for all insulters of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. It's not limited to one sect. This is not a sectarian issue. This is an issue to do with the principles of Al-Islam. So, or those people who accepted knighthood from the Queen, even though they know that the Queen has knighted Salman Rushdie, and then they will use the British card. One of them said to me, why are you living here? I said, I am born here, you are the immigrant. You're the immigrant, you came here out of choice. And I am not living here, by the way. I'm going to Al-Maghrib Al-Aqsa very soon, and after that I will be going to back to Pakistan. So we come here, being born here, we are doing da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will speak on issues even while being here. As for, he mentioned also that you sign on and you take benefits. I have never taken benefits from this country. You cannot go and even check any registration that this government has or any taxes. These people who are involved with governments. I signed on once in my life, and my father said to me that you are a talib al-ilm and you are going to become a scholar, or you are attempting to become a scholar. You should never eat from this money. And he made me give that money in sadaqah. It was done only once, and it was something like 50 pound, and I gave it in sadaqah to one of the madaris, and I have never signed on in my life again. Neither do we take money for speeches. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us sustenance. So there is no fear of speaking in defense of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So he says, قَرَأْتُ فِي جَرِيمٍ الأهرام المصرية خبر شاب هندي. He goes, I read in the newspaper, Egyptian newspaper called Ahram Pyramids, that a young Indian man, اسمه عبد القيوم. His name was عبد القيوم. He could have easily been related to Sayyidi al-Mufti عبد القيوم الهزاري رحمه الله تعالى. غيور, من غيور. They had غيرة, scholars of أهل السنة والجماعة who stood up for issues. سمع الحاكم الإنجليزي للهندي يشتم النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. That he heard an English leader, a person who was a leader of that area, insulting the Messenger صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. فقتله, he killed him. والإنجليز كانوا في الهند ظلمة جبارين. And we know that the English in India were oppressors and جبارين. People who were oppressors. And they are oppressors still today in Iraq and in Afghanistan. And they are the cause of the fitna of the Yahud in Al-Quds al-Sharif, the English. And at the same time, they are also one of the many causes of why people want to get rid of the law of the insult of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because they defended who? Salman Rushdie. They still are protecting Salman Rushdie. Taxpayers' money is being spent in protecting an Indian man, and then the working class Englishman of this country is insulting us. when the upper middle classes of this country are protecting an Indian man. So he says, فَاسْتَكْثَرُوا هَذِهِ الْجُرْأَةَ وَاسْتَعْظَمُوهَا وَقَدَّمُوهُ لِلْمُحَاكَمَةِ. They obviously found this action of the man to be great and an action of rebellion, so they took him to the court. They took him to the court, وَحُكِمَ بِعِدَامِهِ, and the judgment was given for capital punishment. فَلَمَّا سَمِعَتْ أُمُّهُ الْحُكْمَ عَلَيْهِ, when his mother heard of this, زغردت فرحا, she became happy. His mother became happy. وقالت ابني يموت شهيدا, she said, my son shall die a martyr. وصدقت فإنه مات شهيدا, and she was truthful in this, and her son died a martyr رضي الله عنه وعنها. Allah be well pleased with her, and Allah be well pleased with her son. And we know of cases where near Kashmir there is a tomb of one of the people who killed a person who insulted the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during the imperial times of the British alayhimu la'natullah. So other works which mention this hukam, this ruling, is As-Sarim al-Maslul ala Shatim al-Rasul. We know this work of Ibn Taymiyyah. A later scholar called Badruddin Muhammad bin Ali bin Muhammad, he, Al-Ba'li, Al-Hanbali, rahimahullah, done a summary of this work. And he has a chapter where he compiles the statement of the ulama regarding the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. He says, فصل ثم نعود إلى مقصود المسألة فنقول قد ثبت أن كل سب وشتم يبيح الدم فهو كفر وإلا لم يكن كل كفر سبا ونحن نذكر عبارات العلماء. He mentions firstly الإمام أحمد رحمه الله تعالى. قال الإمام أحمد رضي الله عنه من شتم الرسول أو تنقصه مسلما كان أو كافرا فعليه القتل ولا يستتاب. That anyone who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam tries pointing out a defect in him, obviously the person who tries finding a defect in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he himself is defective. Whether he is a Muslim in claimant to being a Muslim or a kafir, then he must be killed. وَقَالَ مَنْ ذَكَرَ شَيْئًا يُعَرِّضُ بِذِكْرِ رَبِّي فَعَلَيْهِ الْقَتْلُ وَقَالَ أَصْحَابُنَا التعرض لسب الله وسب رسوله ردة كالتصريح. Anyone who attacks the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he is an apostate. He is an apostate from the deen. And then he quotes, وَلَا يَخْتَلِفُ أَصْحَابُنَا أَنَّ قَذْفَ أُمِّهِ هُوَ مِنْ جُمْلَةِ سَبِّهِ الْمُوجِبِ لِلْقَتْلِ وَأَغْلَظُ. That our companions, meaning who? The Hanabila, the companions of Imam Ahmad radiallahu an, and the people of his school, do not differ that the one who insults the mother of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, then he must also be killed. And this is more dire, meaning his insulting of the mother of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is more dangerous. So we know of people who are affiliated with the Yahud that they insult the mother of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam by calling her kafira. And al-ghayratul islamiyya, this Islamic, how did you translate it? Decency must make us think that anyone who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, we must press our governments to instate the blasphemy law. And anyone who tries repealing this, we must get rid of them, meaning imprison them. Like what has happened recently in Pakistan, where people have tried getting rid of the blasphemy law and the ulama have stood up. Now, he quotes Al-Imam Al-Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, and this quotation from Al-Imam Al-Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala is well known. Everyone knows this quotation. You can even buy the Kitab al-Shifa in the English language. And you can look at the Shifa of Al-Imam Qadi Iyad in book number 4. So I will not quote that, But one thing which he mentions later, he has قَدْ اتَّفَقَتْ نَصُوصُ الْعُلَمَاءِ مِنْ جَمِيعِ الطَّوَائِفِ عَلَى أَنَّ التَّنَقُّسَ بِهِ كُفْرٌ مُبِيحٌ لِلدَّمِ وَهُمْ فِي اسْتِتَابَتِي عَلَى مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنَ الْخِلَافِ وَلَا فَرْقَ فِي ذَلِكَ بَيْنَ أَنْ يَقْصِدَ عَيْبَهُ أَوْ لَا يَقْصِدَهُ. That the stipulations of the ulama from all the groups have agreed that trying to find a defect for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is kufr, disbelief, something which makes the blood of that person halal, meaning he must be killed. And they differ over one thing, which is whether that the repentance of that person is accepted or not. But they agree on whether he intends to insult the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam or does not intend. If we know that a word in that language carries the meaning of insult, and then someone uses that word to insult the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and then continuously uses that word, and then writes books in defending his statement, there is no doubt regarding his kufr. So we do not know how this author of Iman Kufr and Takfir has played around with this passage of Al-Imam Subki rahimahullah ta'ala, when he was clearly referring to the event of Ifk. And he was talking about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam himself forgiving his own right in his lifetime, because he knew with his ilmul ghayb, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him. And we will come on to that also. Who is a munafiq and who is not? As for the verses in Al-Quran al-Kareem which mention to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam that you do not know who the munafiqoon are, then those verses are mansukh, abrogated. Because later the knowledge of the hypocrites was given to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. That is a different subject. In my hand now, I have Al-Fatawa Al-Alamgiriya, which is known as Al-Fatawa Al-Hindiya. And in this reliable fatwa work, which was compiled by many ulama of Hind, in Kitab Al-Siyar, in the Book of Jihad, we have a chapter on the Ridda, the Murtad, the one who apostates from Al-Islam. Now, these modernists, or these people who cloak themselves with the maulid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and are calling for an abrogation of the Murtad law or a revision of the Murtad law, the only reason they are calling for this is either they do not understand the Murtad law, or they genuinely have an agenda, which is in order to endanger the Sharia. They cannot explain the Murtad law, because we have to understand that the Murtad law, the apostate law, only applies in an Islamic state. If someone becomes a Murtad in Darul Harb, like England, which is a non-Muslim country, if someone becomes an apostate, no Muslim calls for the killing of that person. No Muslim calls for the killing of that individual. This is not the Murtad law. The Murtad law applies in the Muslim lands, and even there, then there must be a trial. And the person is kept in for 3 days, and in the Hanafi school, the woman is not killed, and the child is not killed. So, the Murtad law only applies in those lands. So if someone wants to become a Murtad in the Muslim lands, he has the freedom to leave the Muslim lands and come to non-Muslim lands and leave the religion of Islam. Islam gives him this freedom that he can leave the Muslim lands and then become an apostate. Therefore, the Murtad law in the modern context is similar to treachery. If someone tries killing the queen in this country, then he must face the capital punishment. On paper, that is the law. In the same way, in the Muslim world, if someone leaves the religion of Islam by him becoming an apostate in the Muslim lands, then he has committed an action by showing his treachery to the state. But he has the freedom to leave the Islamic state and do what he wants in the non-Muslim countries, even though he will be punished in the hereafter. So this apostate law is taken out of context by extremists who call for the killing of apostates in non-Muslim lands, and also by modernists who are calling for the revision of the apostate law. In this chapter, he has the chapter of those insults which relate to the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam. وَمِنْهَا مَا يَتَعَلَّقُ بِالْأَنْبِيَاءِ عَلَيْهِمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. It's a whole chapter of examples of how someone can insult the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. For instance, he mentions, لَوْ قَالَ لِشَعْرِ النَّبِيِّ sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam شُعَيْرٌ يَكْفُرُ عِنْدَ بَعْضِهِمْ. That whoever says to the hair of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam شُعَيْرٌ, a small شُعَيْر, يَكْفُرُ عِنْدَ بَعْضِهِمْ, he will commit kufr according to some of them. And the reason why the others differed is not because they did not consider this kufr. The reason for difference is because the word shu'ayr is sometimes not used to insult. But what we are talking about, when someone has clearly insulted and then says, I did not mean, he's not talking about that context. When someone clearly insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and then says, I do not intend insult, and in the nomenclature of that language, the wording that he has used, it is an insult, and he is a kafir, a murtad. An example of this, that someone says, وَلَوْ قَالَ رَجُلٌ مَعَ غَيْرِهِ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُحِبُّ كَذَا. If someone says to someone else that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم loved such and such thing, بأن قال مثلا كان يحب القرعة, that for instance he says he loved pumpkin, فقال ذلك الغير أنا لا أحبه فهذا كفر, that the other person replies by saying I do not like it, then he has committed kufr. وهكذا روي عن أبي يوسف رحمة الله تعالى عليه أيضا. It has been narrated like this from Al-Imam Abu Yusuf رحمه تعالى, and this incident of Imam Abu Yusuf rahimahullah ta'ala is also mentioned by Mullah Ali Qari in his Sharh al-Fiqh al-Akbar, and it's also in the Fatawa Hindiya, showing that the one who insults the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam with clear words which mean insult, clear words which have a meaning of insult, and then he says later that I did not intend to insult, that person has still insulted. When they say qala ba'duhum la, they mean those words which are not an insult at all in nomenclature. Then you have to look at the context of what the person said. You understand the difference between the two? While when we look at the ibarat, the texts that are coming, we will see that they do not fall into that category. Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala wrote an epistle called the Pen in English. It's available in English. He wrote it in Urdu initially, and they have translated this. I bought over, believe it or not, it was published in 95, and I bought this nearly 13 years ago when I was a child. So we grew up on these works. We grew up on these works. These are were our bread and butter. And this was one of the first works I read on this subject, and I still have the original copy. As you can tell, the price mark that was on there, I took that off at that time, and that remains from that time. The work is called The Penalty of Insulting the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. At the end, they placed an addendum of the teacher of our teachers, the Allama, the very learned scholar of Pakistan, Allama Sa'id Ahmed Al-Kadhimi rahmallahu ta'ala, from the children of Sayyidi Musa Kadhim rahmallahu ta'ala, a very learned scholar. And he mentions in his epistle, which I have in the original language also, he mentions firstly Imam Shihabuddin Al-Khifaji Al-Hanafi rahmallahu ta'ala. This is the work he is quoting. Nasimu Riyad fi Shahi Shifa Al-Qadi Iyad. And I think you have a copy also. He has Mullah Ali Qari's commentary. Our beloved brother who's doing good work here for the cause of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Allah preserve him. In this work, I'll give you the original quote from here, which is very relevant. This is the original passage which he is quoting. He says, the verdict of infidelity for insulting the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam will depend upon the apparent words, and no consideration will be given to the intention and the purpose of the person committing the insult and the circumstances of the time. This is what he says here. He says, وَلِذَا قَالَ إِبْنُ حَجَرٍ بَعْدَ سِيَاقِكَ كَلَامِ الْمُصَنِّفِ وَمَا ذَكَرَهُ ظَاهِرٌ مُوَافِقٌ لِقَوَاعِدِ مَذْهَبِنَا إِذِ الْمَدَارُ فِي الْحُكْمِ بِالْكُفْرِ عَلَى ظَوَاهِرِ وَلَا نَظَرَ لِلْمَقْصُودِ النِّيَّاتِ وَلَا نَظَرَ لِقَرَائِنِ حَالِهِ. This is that statement in the original which he's quoting. And he gives only one leeway for a new Muslim, someone who has accepted Islam. And you know, when the context of when these authors will mention a new Muslim, they will talk about a new Muslim in non-Muslim lands. So unless the people who are advocating this are new Muslims, we can forgive, we can excuse them. But people who have claimed to have done suluk and who have claimed, who claim to have studied under the ulama, cannot make simple mistakes. But Allama Sa'id Ahmad Qazmi, after quoting this quote from Al-Khafaji, this is why we believe that the people who are advocating this have not read the Shifa of Al-Imam Al-Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, and if they have read it, then this makes their situation even worse. He states, and it's very important what he states, if this wasn't so, the door to insulting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam would never close. Because every insulter would be acquitted, saying that his intention and objective was not to commit contempt. So this is silly. What the author of Iman, Kufr, Takfir is advocating is silly, because it goes against clearly the context of which Al-Imam al-Subki rahimahullah ta'ala gave, which was to a specific case regarding the munafiqun and the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Later on, the teacher of our teachers rahimahullah ta'ala states, let me say, and he states something similar to what I quoted from Al-Imam Badruddin al-Hassani rahimahullah ta'ala, let me say that the punishment of execution of an insult of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam is a had punishment, which is a right of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam himself. Although insulting the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam is also a cause of grave torture for his ummah, to comply with such a had is the right of the ummah as well, but not directly, rather indirectly through the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was authorized by Allah to forego this right in the case of anyone he chose. Anyone he chose, as is proved from some other examples regarding the injunctions of the Sharia, which show that Allah Ta'ala had given him the authority in certain matters. For example, it has been reported by Sayyiduna Barra bin Azib radiallahu ta'ala, and that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had ordered Hazrat Sayyiduna Abu Barda radiallahu anhu to sacrifice a goat kid, and said, this sacrifice is not lawful for anyone else but you. Meaning he made a ruling specific to that person. So any examples where you find that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam may have forgiven someone, then this was his right. And as for this quote from Al-Imam al-Subki, it was clearly taken out of context. Now we move on to Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala. And Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala has become a hero for those who love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and a person who is attacked by modernists. People who are modern do not like Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala. But even though they do not like him, we have to look at one thing here, is that they say regarding Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan that he was a person who done takfir, meaning gave the fatwa, the verdict of the disbelief of the Diobandi ulama. They make it seem to the uninformed public that he gave this fatwa because he was such an ardent lover of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which made him overlook the rules of fatwa. Some people say this. So they say this in order to make the lovers of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan happy because they admit that he was a lover of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. But in reality, this is a sugar-coated insult. A sugar-coated insult. We must go back to the fatawa of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala. And I know for a fact that the writer of Iman, Kufr and Takfir, the appalling article, shows that he does not have mutala'a. He has not looked at these works. The very last volume of Fatawa Ridawiya, Al-Ataya Al-Nabawiya fi Fatawa Ridawiya, volume 30. It has many epistles in praise of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, like Al-Amn wal-Ula, and other beautiful works in praise of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. He has a work called Tamheed-e-Iman. In Urdu, Tamheed-e-Iman. In Arabic, we'll say Tamheed-ul-Iman. But what he mentions here on page 353 is regarding the precaution he took before declaring anyone a kafir. The precaution he took before declaring anyone a kafir. I had also with me, which I forgot to bring, the maktubat of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, the letters he wrote to those people who had insulted the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam for many years. But here he mentions, isse ziyada ki hame hajat na thi, magar befadlihi ta'ala, hum inki kadhabi kada roshan saboot deke, har musliman par unka muftari hona aftab se ziyada zahir ho jaye. Saboot bihamdihi ta'ala, tahriri, wo bhi chupa hua, wo bhi na aaj ka balke salaha saal ka, jin jin ki takfir کا اتحام علماء اہل سنت پر رکھا ان میں سب سے زیادہ گنجاش اگر ان صاحب کو ملتی تو اسماعیل دہلوی میں کہ بے شک علماء اہل سنت نے اس کے کلام میں بے کثرت کلمات کفریہ ثابت کیے اور شائع فرمائے. And he mentions his book سبحان الصبوح عن عیب کذب مقبوح, which he wrote in the year 1309. In this passage, I want to highlight the passage, Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan mentions a few of his works. What year is it now? 1432. He wrote his book on Subhan al-Sabuh in the year 1309. And then, and remember, the other mistake of the author of Iman, Kufr and Takfir is that he says Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan did Takfir of Rashid Ahmad Gangohi based on the Imkan al-Kadhib issue. This is not true, and a blunder. The fatwa of Kufr was given on wuqu' al-kithb. It was not given on inkar al-kathib. So this is a major blunder. He makes another blunder when he translates. He says that Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala translated the term mustahil aradi, extrinsically impossible, as inkar al-kathib, not knowing maybe what nuance this may carry in the Arabic language. This is also false. In Fatawa Rashidiyya, Rashid Ahmad Gangohi uses the term Inkan Kadhib himself. And we will go on to the fatwa which Darul Ulum Dioband has given. But Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan says, he mentions his second work, Al-Kawkabatu Shihabiyya fi Kufriyati Abil Wahabiyya, which he wrote in 1312. He did not do takfir of the Salafis at that time, and neither did he do takfir of the Diobandis. He wrote this work in 1312. He wrote this work in 1312. Even though he says Kufriyati Abil Wahabiyya, he quotes passages which consist of kufr, but he did not do takfir of the individual. He did not do takfir, declare as an apostate the individual. Then he wrote a third work, which was written a year earlier, but he mentions it at the third, Sallu Suyuf al-Hindiya ala Kufriyati Ibab al-Najdiya, the unsheathing of the Indian swords upon the disbelief of the old man of Najd. And he wrote this in the year 1311. Then, even in this work, he mentions very clearly that I took precaution and I did not do takfir of any Muslim. I did not declare any Muslim a disbeliever, but he pointed out their mistakes. Then he wrote a fourth work izalatul ar bi hajr al karaim an kilab an nar, written in 1316. He wrote this work in the year 1316. Then he wrote a fifth work. You can take these works now. He wrote a fifth work. He mentions the fifth work and he says, even then, even in his work Subhan al-Sabuh, which he wrote on the topic of Imkan al-Kadhib, he did not declare the Diobandiya as kuffar, as disbelievers. He compiled all of these and then he says, Musalmano, ye roshan zahir wadih, qahir ibarat tumhare peshe nazar hai, jine chuppe huye das das, aur baz ko satra aur tasnif ko 19 saal huye. Basically, he says that these ibarat, these texts, have been around for some of them for 10 years. This is an expression, meaning they have been around for 10 years. Some of them have been around for 17 years. And some of the statements have been around for 19 years. And during that period, he wrote refutations of those statements. And he wrote letters to these people, but they did not reply to his letters. And neither did they clarify their position. So you have 10 years, 17 years and 19 years mentioned by Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan in volume 30 and in other parts of his fatawa. But I did not want to bring too many books to bore people, but to give you an idea that there is a bigger picture to what is going on. So then Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, rahmallahu ta'ala, in the year 1320, wrote a commentary to a work of a previous scholar, a book known as Al-Mu'taqad Al-Muntaqad in Arabic, a nice text on Kalam. Ilm al-Kalam, the science of theology. He wrote a commentary called Al-Mustanad Al-Mu'tamad. And he wrote this in the year 1320. He wrote this in the year 1320 and he compiled the statement found in Hifzul Iman and Tahdhirun Nas and other works, and then presented this work to the ulama of the Haramain, who then applied the fatwa on the Diobandi scholars. This is the context. But I want to go back slightly in time. This is earlier scholars had also pointed out the mistakes of the ulama of Diobandi, and this is just one book which, because I was given notification of a few days, this is one book of many which were written prior to Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, even before Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala was born, in refutation of Ismail al-Dahlawi, who first came out with the position of Mustahil Aradi in the Indian subcontinent to promote this position. The position of Mustahil Aradi, how did the Diobandis state this position? We have here volume 15 of Fatawa Ridwiya, which, and by the way, the majority of the Fatawa is a work of fiqh. Volume 14 and 15 mainly deal with deviant sects. And the other volumes deal in either in fiqh or love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. In this volume, he wrote this work, as we mentioned earlier, in the year 1307. And this was the book written in reply to the claim of the Diobandiya that it is extrinsically impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lie. What they mean by this is stated clearly in a fatwa given. This is given by sufa.org. www.asufa.org, an institute based in Birmingham. And many of these so-called scholars who are guising themselves in the Mawlid and going around doing Mawlid, but they carry deviant positions, also go to this place known as Sufa Institute. They try inviting other ulama, but the ulama should generally avoid going to deviant places because this can tarnish their reputation. The question, listen to this. is this fatwa from Darul Uloom Dioband correct? Some people say that it is wrong and Allah does not have the real power to lie. Can you explain it, please? And the question from the question gives the fatwa from Darul Uloom Dioband, the current Darul Uloom Dioband. And the position of Rashid Ahmed Gongoy is the following. As mentioned here, and they mentioned the position, they say, most of you understand Urdu. Or shall I translate this passage? Because we are recording this and non-Urdu speaking people will be watching, I will translate as I go. Imkani kis kya hai? What is imkanul kathib? Kya Allah Ta'ala jhoot bol sakte hai? Aur kya bolte hai? Kyunki humare diobandi ulama kehte hai ke Allah Ta'ala jhoot bol sakte hai. That's the question, the question. So he says, can Allah lie? And does he lie? Because our Diobandi ulama say that Allah can lie. This is the question. And he says, this is answered in 11th August 2007 from Darul Uloom Dioband. So in the same year Iman, Kufr and Takfir was written, this atrocious fatwa was also given. Qudrat ala al-kizb mustalzim sudur nahi. That being capable of lying does not mean that it will come about. Being capable of lying does not mean it will come about. Kizb bari ta'ala mumkin bi zat ya mumtani' bil ghayr hai. That lying for Allah the Most High is possible in itself, but impossible extrinsically, like the author of Iman Kufr Takfir has later approved of this position. In itself it is possible, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses not to lie, therefore it is impossible. Kizb chunke qabih hai, because lying is ugly, isliye iska sudur bari ta'ala se na qabih hua. Because it is ugly, it will never has never emanated from Allah the Most High. Warna kabhi hoga, and na kabhi hoga, and it will never happen. Inna Allah Ta'ala munazzahun min an yutasafa bi sifat al-kidh. That Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is munazzah, meaning transcendent of being described with lying. Wa laysat fi kalamihi sha'ibatul kidh. And there is nothing in his speech which has lie, abada, ever. Kama qala Allah Ta'ala, wa man asdaqu min Allahi qila. Who is more truthful than Allah? Now this is a very contradictory statement. Very contradictory. And then this reference is given. Al-Muhannad al-Mufannad, page 55. This is a recent book which a Gujarati individual from England edited and republished this work in England to revive the fitna. Some people are saying that the people who are the followers of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan are the troublemakers. I would like to ask, if we, the lovers of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan and the lovers of the scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah like Imam Al-Khafaji, Imam Yusuf Nabahani, Imam Badruddin Al-Aini, Imam Badruddin Al-Hasani rahimahumullah ta'ala, are the troublemakers, then I have the following questions. Husam al-Haramain never reached the shores of Syria prior to the publication of Al-Muhannad. Refutations of people like the author of Iman, Kufr and Takfir were never done by our ulama and students prior to the writing of this article in 2007. No one refuted this subject or brought up this subject in public prior to the writing of this work, atrocious work, Iman, Kufr and Takfir. And then statements which are made on websites, which we'll go into later, these statements were not refuted except after people came out with this these atrocious fatawa, and where they made the common believer, common Muslim, think that it is intrinsically possible but extrinsically impossible for Allah to lie. Meaning, it is allowed, but it is only impossible because Allah has chosen. We ask, how do you know? This is very contradictory, because he says, The evidence for Allah not lying is the Quran. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا. Who is more truthful than Allah? The Quran is telling us this. But we say if Allah has chosen not to lie according to you, then how do you know the Quran is true? How do you know the Quran is speaking the truth here? So before people, common people, the students of this individual, this researcher who lives in Hayyul Kharabsha now, American researcher, the students of this researcher prior did not hold this position. None of them held this position. And if they are sincere, they will not follow this man in their mistake in accordance with what we have quoted from Al-Imam Abdul Wahhab al-Sha'rani rahmallahu ta'ala. That people can make mistakes even after they have done suluk at the hands of a sheikh. Now, a sheikh Muhammad al-Hashimi rahmallahu ta'ala, this teacher of a sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Shaghuri rahmallahu ta'ala, has two works, Al-Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. I advise the American researcher and his students to go back to the teachings of a sheikh Muhammad al-Hashimi rahmallahu ta'ala. Go back to the teachings of your predecessors. Now, what does he say then? Jo shakhs zaate bari se sudure kizb ka qail ho wo kafir hai. Whoever believes that lying will emanate from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he is a kafir. So they believe it will not emanate, but he has power over it and he chooses not to lie. Lekin sudur na hone se qudrat ka salb lazim nahi aata. However, by saying that it will not emanate, we have not negated him having power over it. Or you can translate this like, by saying that it will never emanate, then this does not mean that this is not a negation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having power over life. Agar qudrat na mani jaye to ajz lazim aata. Because if you do not believe he has power over it, then you are saying that he is incapable. Ajz. So you have to say Allah has qudra, power over lying, otherwise you are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ajz, meaning you are insulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Incapability.
By ascribing incapability to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are you not insulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Of course. So their position by default would be that the Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah insulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, كَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ كَخِلَافٍ. He quotes the verse, Allah has power over everything. I would advise that you go back to the works of Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah, like the Matn al-Sunusiyah, and the works of Al-Imam al-Sunusi rahmatullahu ta'ala, like Umm al-Barahin and other works, which also the researcher from America, who lives in Hayy al-Kharabsha now, misquoted in his article. He misquoted the work of Al-Imam al-Sunusi rahmatullahu ta'ala. And he has not re-edited his work and rendered the mistake. The same copy is still online. And also, if you return back to a simple tafsir, I'm sure you have tafsir of Jalalain. In the tafsir of Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti, if you can open it up on Inna Allah ala kulli shayin qadir in Surah Al-Baqarah, you will find what Imam Suyuti rahmallahu ta'ala states. Isse malum hota hai ke kis par qudrat zarur hai. What is known from this, that Allah has capability of lying. Kyunche agar qudrat na ho to, wo sidq par majboor hoga. If he does not have power of lying, then he is forced to tell the truth. Majboor, meaning is jabar, coerced to tell the truth. Aur ajz wa majboori Allah ta'ala ki zaat se bahut ba'id hai. And being incapable is far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person does not even know simple ilm al-kalam. They teach sharh al-aqaid and they are fooled. People in the Arab world, that the Madrasa to Dioband is one of the great azhars of the Indian subcontinent. They have fooled many people into thinking this, yet these people cannot understand simple works like Sharh al-Aqaid of Imam al-Taftazani, or simple works of Aqidah. And how will they understand detailed works like Sharh al-Mawaqif Sharh al-Maqasid, al-Musayara and al-Musamara, etc. So he says, غرض یہ کہ فعل قبی تو قبی ہوتا ہے لیکن فعل قبی پر قدرت قبی نہیں ہوتی. That a disgusting action is disgusting, but being capable of doing a disgusting action is not disgusting. وقوع قبی ہوتا ہے, however it coming about is also ugly. چونکہ ذات باری تعالی سے ممکن نہیں ہے, because it is not possible for Allah سبحانہ وتعالی. ان امثال إن أمثال هذه الأشياء مقدور قطعا لكنه غير جائز الوقوع عند أهل السنة والجماعة من الأشائرة. He quotes a line from Al-Muhannad Al-Mufannad. And the, by the way, the refutation to Al-Muhannad is a book written by Mawlana Hashmat Ali Khan رحمه الله, was a learned scholar, and he wrote a refutation, complete refutation of Muhannad. In refutation of this logic, he has many passages where he refutes Imkan al-Kadhib. Those interested can get this word. Note, there's a note now. There would be a note needed after so much confusion. لہذا اللہ تعالیٰ کا کس پر قادر ہونا مذکورہ بلا تفصیل کی بنا پر بلا شبہ صحیح ہے. This is the note that Allah تعالیٰ having power over the previously mentioned things بلا شبہ صحیح ہے, without any doubt is true. مگر عام مسلمانوں کو سمجھ میں نہیں آنے کی وجہ سے حیرت تشویش اور فتنہ میں ڈالنے والی ہے. That placing the common Muslim, it will place the common Muslim in حیرہ, meaning unable to comprehend this, and doubt and fitna, tribulation for the common Muslim. Someone may ask, why did you write this fatwa on the internet? If it places the common Muslim into doubt, why did you place this fatwa on the internet? Then I do not think our researchers, new researchers on this subject, know of these things in the Urdu language. So many things have been written in the Urdu language on this subject that I do not even know what to quote. Our ulama for the past 100 years, because many people accuse the ulama of Ahl-Sunnah of being involved in polemics, but they had to be involved in polemics because of this disgusting belief which was being promulgated in those regions and is being promoted here now. So then he says, اس لیے اس کو عوام کے سامنے ذکر نہیں کرنا چاہیے. You should never mention this in front of the عوام. This is why we state that the taqiyah of the Diobandis, when they go to Saudi Arabia, they act like followers of Kitab al-Tawheed of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab. When they go to Al-Sham al-Sharif, they act like followers of the ulama of Al-Sham. And especially those who come from the West. When they go from their institutes, from here, they go to Asham al-Sharif and perform maybe even Mawlid. But what did I mention at the beginning? The Mawlid is being used by different people, perennialists, Diobandiya, different sects who carry different beliefs, as a guise to attract the common Sunni to their agenda, even people who are involved with Ikhwan al-Muslimin, the political group. Then عن علي رضي الله عنه حدث الناس بما يعرفون أتحبون أن يكذب الله ورسوله. Do you, he says, quotes from Sayyidina Ali كرم الله وجل كريم, that inform people of what they know of. Do you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم to be lied? Meaning people say that this is false. Meaning he's saying this is one of those things you mention after someone has done his 40-day gushed and has spent time with the tabligh, and then after many, many years, then you break this down to him that our bazurghs and our ulama held this position. Our elders held this position. This is what is basically being said. Then, another note, is Ali radiallahu anhu, is Masla ki mazid wazahat ke liye fatawa rashidiya. He says, in order to have more detail regarding this, go and check fatawa rashidiya, page number 92. Par is silsila mein Maulvi Nazir Ahmed Khan Rampuri ke ishkalat ka jawab. That Nazir Ahmed Khan Rampuri wrote refutation to them, and they replied to him, ka jawab bi qalam Hazrat Haji Imdadullah Sahib Muhajir Makki. So he attributes this to Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki, that he too also took this position. Whether that inscription is true or false, that's a different subject. But the point is that they believe this. Then, now look at the answer from the Sufa Institute, which we have people who are promoting this Iman Kufr Takfir article, that trend of thought. Those people who are on that trend of thought, who associate themselves with this institute, he writes, and this man, his name is, they call him Mufti Muhammad Sajjad. That is his name. And he is not from Portasher. I'm from Portasher, and some people tried ascribing him to Portasher. We do not have this. This man is from Lala Musa. He's not from Portasher. Officially, people consider me as the Maulvi of Portasher. And Alhamdulillah, we have Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah Faiz in Portasher. So look, and this is one thing I wanted to mention, is regarding young people should learn where your homes are from back home. You are not English or British. You carry a British passport, which is for your convenience. So you can pass different countries and live in safety. And we are in fact where we are from. And you should know where you are from back home. This is not, some people want us to forget where we are from, to forget our identities. This involves a bleaching of not only our aqidah, but also our very identities. We should learn where we are from back home, and we should learn our mother tongues. Never forget these things. This doesn't automatically mean a hatred for other peoples and other nations. No. Why would we hate the common working class of Britain when in fact they are the oppressed people of the upper and middle classes? They are the oppressed people of the white upper middle classes, not oppressed by Muslims. So this does not negate automatically. When you mention these kind of things, people automatically think that you are saying be rude to the disbelievers. No. We are saying show good manners to the disbelievers and invite them to Al-Islam, but never forget your origins and your roots. He writes in reply, the fatwa explains sufficiently the issue. The issue of Imkani Kizb is in reality an issue of establishing the absolute power of Allah Ta'ala, a point of belief established emphatically by numerous texts. To argue against this is obviously ascribing to Allah Ta'ala a weakness. Ma'ad Allah. He's saying that by saying it is intrinsically impossible, you are saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is weak, and should show one the falsity and deception of those who make it an issue, meaning us. He's trying to say that we are deceiving people. We are deceiving people. Go and look at the works of Sayyid Muhammad al-Hashimi rahimahullah ta'ala. Go and look at the works of Ahl Sunnati wa Jama'ah and their works of all those ulama who came prior to Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala, and you will find that they took our position, or we take their position. Then he says, and should show one the falsity and deception of those who make it an issue. Furthermore, there is nothing untoward about accepting the possibility of something. There is nothing untoward of accepting the possibility of something, as in this case it is a possibility that can never materialize. The reason for this is that just as the texts speak of Allah's absolute power, they also tell us that Allah Ta'ala is perfect and far beyond, above any kind of defects whatsoever. Thus Allah Ta'ala will not lie, but this is due and by His wish or irada, not because of some inherent weakness in His power and capability. This is like the reasoning of Ibn Hazm in Al-Fisl, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's capability of having a child, but He chooses not to. Even though the takfir of Ibn Hazm was not done on this point, takfir was not made on him because of him saying that he chooses not to. And the takfir on the Diyobandiya was not placed because of this. The takfir was not done on them because of this. It was done because of a fatwa of wuqoo al-kidh. And some people have asked regarding Rashid Ahmed Gongoi's fatwa that he stated of wuqoo al-kidh, where do we find this? I would like to say that some people have made Khalful Wa'id as a sub-branch of Imkan al-Kidh. They have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment will forgive certain sinners and therefore oppose the promise of punishment which He gave to people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive certain people on the Day of Judgment. This is known as Khalful Wa'id, opposing the warning. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us that He will do this. But if certain people choose to make this a sub-branch of Imkan al-Kadhib, then we ask the question, will Khalful Wa'id take place or not? Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive certain people for sins? Yes, He will. So this shows that Khalful Wa'id will take place. So if they are saying that Khalful Wa'id is a sub-branch of Imkan al-Kadhib, in effect they are saying that Imkan al-Kadhib itself will take place. Is this point understood? If they are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that His forgiveness of sinners is a sub-branch of Imkan al-Kadhib, we all agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive sinners. In effect, they are saying that Imkan al-Kadhib will take place. But we will not dwell on this subject any longer, and it is sufficient for people what we have mentioned. And for more detail, you'll find books like Imtina'u al-Nadhir and Tahqiqul Fatwa of Fadl al-Haq, Khair Abadi rahimahullah ta'ala, was from the major ulama of Hind who refuted Ismail al-Dahlawi. And his biography, which is found in Nuzhatul Khawatir by Abdul Hay Farangi, who's the father of Abul Hasan al-Nadwi, not to be confused with Abdul Hay al-Laknawi Abul Hasanat, the major scholar. This is another Abdul Hay. He wrote biographies of the ulama of Hind, and the work is known as Nuzhatul Khawatir. He gives a biased biography of the Fadl al-Haq Khair Abadi. A biased biography. And anyone who opposed Ismail al-Dahlawi, because the fitna started with Ismail al-Dahlawi, he gives a biased biography for that scholar. And ulama who read this work in the Arab world will find the biography of those ulama and read the biased interpretation. I wanted to also mention one thing. Some people have been quoting Faisal al-Tafriqa Bain al-Islami wa Zandaqa al-Imam al-Ghazali rahmallahu ta'ala, and they have extracted a passage from this and applied this to the majority of the non-Muslims today in order to say that the majority of non-Muslims will be saved from the hellfire because the message of Islam has not reached them. Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahmallahu ta'ala clarified this passage in his work which I mentioned, Al-Mustanad Al-Mu'tamad, where he says, Al-Intisaru lil-Imam Hujjat al-Islami al-Ghazali وذكر فضائله والدفع ما أورد عليه ما أورد عليه الإمام القادعية ما أورد عليه. So he mentions here what Al-Qadi Al-Baqilani rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned regarding Imam Ghazali, and from that is a passage which is found in here, but I will not go into detail regarding that. It is sufficient for us to be warned regarding the perennialist fitna. And this fitna of saying that we can make interpretation for those who insult the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Now we go on to practical examples of what took place in the Indian subcontinent. Ismail al-Dahlawi wrote his notorious work, Taqwiyatul Iman. This is Taqwiyatul Iman, the old edition. And Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala compiled the kufriyat of Ismail al-Dahlawi, which are found in this work, over 70 kufriyat, but yet he did not do takfir of Ismail al-Dahlawi. He refused to do takfir. So we will not go into his kufriyat today, but he did have a passage in here, in this work, Sirati Mustaqeem, where, look how many notes our brother Nabil has made on this book. How many points he has taken out. Where the statement regarding the Muslim praying in his prayer and he thinks of a donkey, his prayer is not invalid. But if he thinks of the best of creation, his prayer is invalid. Everyone has heard this statement. This is found in this book, Sirati Mustaqeem. But yet, Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahmatullah ta'ala did not put a fatwa of kufr on him because he had passed away. And there was one possibility of him having done tawbah, repentance. But his contemporaries, like Fadl al-Haq rahmatullah ta'ala, did place a fatwa on him. But because of that one possibility, Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahmatullah ta'ala did not place a fatwa of kufr on him. So, the author of Iman, Kufr and Takfir mentions the passage of Ad-Durr al-Mukhtar that if there is one possibility of Islam and 99 possibilities of kufr, we do not place a fatwa of kufr on him until it becomes clear as day. And we mention that Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahmatullah ta'ala wrote against those people, but he did not place a fatwa on them until he wrote to them for 10 years and some instances 17 years and 19 years. In another part of the fatwa, he mentions, I wrote letters to Ashraf Ali Tanwi for 14 years. And I have the maktubat of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahmatullah ta'ala, those very letters. You can get these letters also, you can buy them. The works which they were taken to task for, with me I have three of those works. Hifdhul Iman, Tahdhirul Nas, and Al-Barahim Al-Qati'ah. Regarding Ashraf Ali Tanwi, your own local Coventry Center, what's the center called? Islamic Academy of Al-Quran, have on their website a biography of Ashraf Ali Tanwi. Some people may say, why did Al-Imam Al-Kawthari praise Ashraf Ali Tanwi? Why did many scholars praise him? A simple answer is because they were not aware of this fitna. Like Al-Imam Al-Kawthari rahimahullah ta'ala was obviously not aware of Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan. And even a Shaykh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda rahimahullah, when he done tahqiq research to the work of Anwar Shah Kashmiri on the descent of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, in the introduction he mentions the list of works of Anwar Shah Kashmiri, and he mentions one work, Sahmul Ghayb ala Kibdi Ahli Rayb, the arrow of the unseen on the liver of the people of doubt, meaning Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan. And he mentions in there, Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda, that this was a refutation of Al-Barelwi, who claimed that the knowledge of Allah and the knowledge of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is equal, and there is no difference between the two, except one is dhati and one is atai, meaning one is in the essence and one is given. This shows that Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda rahimahullah was given misinformation regarding Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan and clearly was not informed of the work of Dawlatul Makkiya and other works of Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan. So we do not attack Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda rahimahullah ta'ala. And we know that misinformation was given by the Diyobandiya. But once the works of Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan are given to ulama in Arabic, and the fatwa of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan are given to them in Arabic, then they have no excuse. They have no excuse after this. And we cannot blame people who tend to be around a specific sheikh for giving misinformation if those shuyukh have those works in Arabic. So, however, the Al-Muhannad, the refutation of Al-Muhannad is not in Arabic. So if they are given Al-Muhannad, then maybe you can make some excuses for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, and this deserves more detail. But your local Diobandi center has a whole biography and great titles for Ashraf Ali Thanwi. But we will overlook these great titles because Al-Imam al-Kawthari also gives him these titles, but he was clearly not aware of Hifzul Iman. Because they presented the work I'la Sunan in Egypt, and because Al-Imam al-Kawthari rahimahullah was into comparative fiqh, he praised him for writing a work or having overlooked the work I'la Sunan because it involved comparative fiqh from the Hanafi perspective. And he praised this endeavor. And we would praise any endeavor which is done for Al-Islam, but we would not do it if we were aware of his insulting statements. No one can prove that Al-Imam Kawthari was aware of his insulting statements. So here they mention on page 11 of 12, rooting out irreligious practices. Every true Islamic reformer roots out the irreligious practices people perform in the name of religion. Through his speeches and writings, Maulana Thanwi battled against all evil innovations in religion and presented Islam as it stood in light of the Quran and Hadith. Maulana Thanwi was deeply concerned about the ignorance of those Muslims who performed many unnecessary acts, perceiving them to be righteous acts of religion. Hence, he wrote many books that dealt with this subject. His book, Hifzul Iman, clearly explains the evils in acts such as grave worshipping, beseeching other than Allah, believing in the omnipresence of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and pious people, and so on. Another work, and he goes on to other works. Here, this clearly shows that either this Gujarati who did the edition of Al-Muhannad is lying, because he performs Maulid and according to them he does grave worshipping and beseeches other than Allah, or these people are lying. Both of them claim to follow the same man. They both follow the same person. One of the two is lying. So let's look at this work, Hifzul Iman, according to them. And with it is Bastul Banan wa Taghir al-Unwan, which he wrote after to defend his statement. After he was taken to task by Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, he wrote these words after Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan passed away. And Bastul Banan literally means spreading the fingertips. And Taghir al-Unwan means changing the address. The passage for which he was taken to task is on page 13. And what happened was, he was asked, and the Diobandiya, we have to thank the author of who lives in Hayy al-Kharabsha for writing Iman, Kufr and Takfir. Why do we have to thank him? In one way we must thank him, and in another way we must dispraise him. Why? Two reasons. One is that prior to the writing of Iman, Kufr and Takfir article, the fitna was asleep in the UK. And when this issue was brought up to neutral people, people would say that the people who are following Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan are causing trouble. Because our ulama did not believe in Mustahil Aradi and did not say these statements. They denied this, with the exception of a few extremists amongst them. So they called us liars. So personally speaking, we must thank him that we were proven not to be liars. But because the deen means more to us than our own personal selves, it was a disaster. Because now they are affirming these statements and defending them. And also defending the position of Mustahil Aradi openly. Defending the position that it is possible for Allah to lie, but he chooses not to do so. Or it is impossible, extrinsically impossible. And they quote works, for instance, I marked off, this is a book which I mentioned before, Al-Masail Al-Khilafiyya, Bayn Al-Ashairah Al-Maturidiyah. On page 120, you find the Bahath on the Qawl, which is attributed to Ash'a'irah regarding the dispute between Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala and Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. And they will quote passages like this, but when you look at this, the context of the passage later, further down, the author states that this position may not be correctly reported from Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. But what they do is they find odd passages in these works and present them as the mainstream view. It is incumbent on people to go back to the ulama and have these quotes checked. Otherwise you will find that they misquote many works, like the author of Iman, Kufr and Takfir quoted Al-Imam al-Sunusi, or rather misquoted Al-Imam al-Sunusi. The Shaykh of Al-Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Shaghuri, Muhammad al-Hashmi rahmallahu ta'ala, states that it is wajib, intrinsically impossible for Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam to lie. It is intrinsically impossible for Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam to lie. So if it's intrinsically impossible for Allah, for the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam to lie, what do you think regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That it is intrinsically impossible also. And I would advise him to go back to the words of Sayyid Muhammad al-Hashmi rahmallah and look at the bahth of mustahil dhati and mustahil aradi and what the great Shaykh has to say. So what Ashraf Ali Tanwi was replying to was a question which was sent to him regarding the term alimul ghayb, knower of the unseen, and whether this word can be applied to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
Narae takbir,
Allahu Akbar.
Narae risalat,
ya Rasulullah.
Narae tahqiq,
Akbar.
Narae hadri,
ya Ali.
In the context of what he was replying to was whether you can apply this term alimul ghayb to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And note, Al-Imam Ahmad Rida Khan rahimahullah ta'ala does not apply the word alimul ghayb to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. When he was replying to this, he states that, I'll give you the context and the background, that if you apply this word alimul ghayb to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam because he has knowledge of the unseen, then you must apply it to everyone who has a bit of knowledge of the unseen. This is the context of what he is saying. That if you apply the word alimul ghayb for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, then you must apply it for everyone for whom it is proven that they have knowledge of the unseen. So he says, phir ye ke aapki zaat-e-muqaddasa par ilm-e-ghayb ka hukam kiya jana agar biqawli zayd sahih ho to, that attributing to your noble personality, to the noble personality of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the knowledge of the unseen, if the saying of Zayd is true, دریافت طلب یہ امر ہے کہ اس غیب سے مراد بعد غیب ہے یا کل غیب, that we must seek out whether this is partial knowledge of the unseen or full, complete. اگر بعد علوم غیبیہ مراد ہے, if some partial knowledge is meant, تو اس میں حضور ہی کی کیا تخصیص ہے. What is the specific quality for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So this is istighfaf bin Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to say what is the special quality of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is the specificness for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, specificity for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here. Aisa ilme ghayb to Zayd wa Amr, this kind of knowledge is found for Zayd and Amr. Wa balke har sabi, in fact every child, wa majnoon and madman, بلکہ جميع حيوانات وبهائم, in fact all animals and beasts کے لیے بھی حاصل ہے, for all of them they have attained this, کیونکہ ہر شخص کو کسی نہ کسی ایسی بات کا علم ہوتا ہے, because every person does know something کا علم ہوتا ہے, some type of knowledge جو دوسرے شخص سے مخفی ہے, which is hidden from the other person. تو چاہیے کہ سب کو عالم الغیب کہا جائے. So then you must call every single one of them عالم الغیب. This is the full passage. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And the author of Iman, Kufr, Takfir has made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what his ties with that group are, whether he's receiving money, whether when he goes to see Taqi Uthmani, who was with the banks and backed Islamic mortgages, and now he no longer backs Islamic mortgages. He's taken the money from the banks and he no longer backs them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what this person is receiving from them. Or maybe he is sincere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But this statement is unacceptable. If he refuses to do takfir of an individual, of the right of these words, the minimum he must state is that the reason why I refuse to do takfir is because the person has done tawbah. But even that is refuted by the fact that the author wrote two additional works defending his statement. And then he may say, I believe the statement is kufr, but I do not want to do takfir on the individual because I do not know of his state. That may have been acceptable by many ulama, that at least he believes the statement is kufr, but he went one step ahead and said the statement is not kufr also. Then we have a work known as Tahdhir al-Nas. Before I go on to that, I want to mention the passage in Brahim Qati'a. This Brahim Qati'a, remember, why was the fatwa of Kufr placed on Rashid Ahmed Gongoi? Because he placed the Muqaddima and affirmed this book. That was the reason why fatwa of Kufr was placed on him, one of the reasons. Not because of the Imkan al-Kadhib issue, which the author of Iman, Kufr and Takfir wants us to believe. That is not the case. It was because of his muqaddima to this work and also a fatwa which he gave. But his muqaddima to this work is sufficient and praise of this work. And what do we find in this work? We find on page 50, and remember 51, this is the original Brahim Qati'a, which was published in that time. This is the original edition. And of it states here, Matma'. It does not have Jami' al-Sharafiyya written on the cover. It's the original copy of the original. Exactly. This is where Khalil Ambetwi was from. The area where he is from, it was published there. This is the original copy. And remember, this book has many passages which are disagreeable and insulting. Not one. But this one passage is sufficient to show you the deviancy of the Diobandiya. And people are saying that we are promoting this for sectarian purposes. I mentioned at the beginning that the usul, the principle, applies for everyone. A sectarian person would only dismiss the Diobandiya. We have spoken against the Hassoun, Ahmed Hassoun, and other people who have taken these stances. We have spoken against the British, the Americans, the Jews, on the insulting of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, the Danish, Salman Rushdie, and any other khabith, like the Queen of England herself. We state that she is a khabitha because she protects an insulter of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and she knighted an insulter of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Someone said to me, by carrying a British passport, does it not mean that you have given your pledge to the Queen? No. When I received that passport in order to travel around the world, that passport does not have any loyalty to the Queen. It states you are subject of the Queen, meaning you're living in her country. And being a subject does not mean you are always loyal to someone. You're not a loyal subject. So a sectarian person would only limit this issue to the Diobandiya. But I say no, this is a whole Zionist campaign, a Prenderist campaign, a campaign from many quarters to attack the figure of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, to promote secularism. So here, in order to establish again the topic of ilmul ghayb, in order to mention the topic of ilmul ghayb, he states that you must listen to the following. حاصل غور کرنا چاہیے کہ شیطان و ملک الموت کا حال دیکھ کر علم محیط زمین کا فخر عالم کو خلاف نصوص قطعیہ بلا دلیل محض قیاس فاسدہ سے ثابت کرنا شرک نہیں تو کون سا ایمان کا حصہ ہے. He says that someone presented the argument that whether the shaitan and malakul maut have knowledge of comprehending of what's going on around the world. Shaitan and malakul maut can have knowledge of comprehending what is going on around the world. Someone presented an analysis that if we can establish this knowledge for shaitan and malakul maut, then why do we not establish it for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And more knowledge for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he wants to refute this analysis. And he says that if you say that shaitan and malakul maut, their state is such that they comprehend the knowledge of the earth, then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam establishing this for him is against established nusus, meaning stipulations from the Quran and Hadith, and it is without evidence. Establishing it for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is without evidence, and this is invalid analogy. And establishing this is polytheism. And if it is not polytheism, then what kind of belief is it? Meaning it is not a belief. شیطان و ملک الموت کو یہ وسعت نص سے ثابت ہوئی. That establishing this knowledge for شیطان and for ملک الموت has been established from the stipulation from Quran and Hadith. So he's affirming this knowledge for شیطان and ملک الموت. But he is denying this knowledge for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when he establishes it for شیطان, it is not shirk. But if you establish it for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to him it is shirk. Then he says, فخر عالم کی وسط علم کی کون سی نص قطعی سے ہے کہ جس تمام نص کو رد کر کے ایک شرک ثابت کرتا ہے. That the knowledge of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is established from which nas qat'i, which explicit stipulation that you end up establishing a shirk, polytheism. So this was the context of what he stated, that he established this knowledge for shaitan and malakul maut, and he said this is based on explicit stipulation from Quran and Hadith. We can believe this. But if you establish this for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, firstly he said there is no stipulation from Quran and Hadith, and secondly he stated that it is shirk. If you do establish it, it is shirk. So if it is shirk, meaning what does shirk mean? That we have made the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a partner with Allah. This is according to him. So who have they made a partner with according to their own reasoning? Shaytan. So they are abatatu shaitan according to this reasoning. And I do not say this except wallahi for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not for any sectarian bias towards these people, that this statement is kufr, and to give the analysis with the knowledge of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and then say it is not established, but it is established for shaitan, and if you establish it for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then you have committed shirk, is kufr, is disbelief. So here also he, on the next page, on page 52, he has worse statements where he says اعلی علیین میں روح مبارک علیہ السلام کی تشریف رکھنا اور ملک الموت سے افضل ہونے کی وجہ سے ہرگز ثابت نہیں ہوتا. That if you say the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to the higher abode, then this does not in any way make him any better than ملک الموت. And he goes on to into detail. This book is quite detailed and he has many statements, not one statement. Going on to this work, تحذير الناس. In this work, this is the work of Qasim Nanotwi, the founder of Darul Ulum Dioband. And later on, the Diobandiya, they claimed that Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, when he presented these statements to the ulama of the Haramain, he took three different passages and placed them into one passage, which when placing all three separate passages into one passage becomes kufr. But if you dissect the three passages and place them separately, then it is not kufr. This is what they claim. And on this Sufa Institute, the person, this so-called mufti, has also placed the same answer. This was refuted by the teacher of our teachers, Al-Allama Ahmad Sa'id Qazmi rahimahullah ta'ala, in his work Maqalat, a classical work. He has many volumes of this, where he has refuted many people and clarified many things without insulting, and his tabi'ah, his nature was a very mu'tadil nature. He, rahimahullah ta'ala, by the way, has written many works. For instance, this work, Al-Haqul Mubin, which deals with the accusation that the Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah from the subcontinent, which they call Barelwis, are trigger-happy takfiris. He refuted this claim, and we have amply refuted this from the very work of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan that he wrote for many years. This is Al-Haqul Mubin, from the Maqalat of Imam Al-Kazmi rahimahullah ta'ala, volume 2. And you can get these works online also. So the author of Imam Kufr Takfir, who lives in Hayl Kharabsha, the American, he should have looked at all of these works prior to writing an article, and these are not even 5% of what is written on the subject. Our ulama for the past 100 years have been writing on this subject and have detailed everything. Then there is also a risala here in the work of the teacher of our teachers, rahimahullah ta'ala, where he has written, which is called Tasbih al-Rahman. Tasbih al-Rahman is a detailed epistle written on the subject of whether it is extrinsically impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lie. This is called Tasbih al-Rahman. And he also answered the objections raised at that time. And there are other works written by the contemporary Ghulam Rasul Sa'idi, the commentator to Sahih Muslim. He has also written an epistle on that work. But here, this claim that Al-Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan rahimahullah ta'ala took three different passages and placed them into one passage is dealt with in his Risala al-Tabshir bi Radd al-Tahdhir, where he answers these claims. But the Diobandiya, when they published this work, modern prints, look, Dar al-Isha'at. This is a modern Diobandi publishing house, well known in Pakistan. And look, the Takmila, the completion to this work, is done by, they write, Hadrat, their Hadrat, Mawlana Muhammad Idris Sahib Kandahlawi, showing that the Kandahlawis, like Zakaria Kandahlawi, because some people tried presenting Zakaria Kandahlawi as a person who was not involved in disputes. This is far from the truth. Abul Hassan Nadwi, in the introduction to his translation of Taqwiyatul Iman by Ismail al-Dahlawi, which contains many statements of Kufr, but the fatwa of Kufr was not placed on Ismail al-Dahlawi because it was reported that he repented. But Abul Hassan Nadwi in his translation mentions that he was ordered to translate this book by Zakaria Kandahlawi. So we do not place a fatwa of Kufr on Zakaria Kandahlawi, but we are wary of the Diobandi scholars. We do not place a fatwa of Takfir on anyone unless they positively affirm these texts and believe in them. And even then we leave it to the Muftiyan, the ulama of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. But we believe anyone who believes these statements has committed kufr. Anyone who states these statements and believes they are valid has committed kufr. As the same goes for any statement of kufr. Whether someone believes in the statement of Ahmad Hassoun and in Al-Fatawa Al-Alamgiriya, there are passages clearly which mention similar statements to the statements of this man, Ahmad Hassoun, who is backed by the Nusayriya in Damascus, Khadilahumullah, who promote also Rawafid beliefs, to the extent that some scholars have gone to the extent of saying there is no difference between Ikhwanuna Ja'fariya, between us and the Ja'fariya, meaning the Twelvers, even though we know clearly that the Twelvers insult Sayyiduna Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu an, the Iranian Twelvers. They believe in Naqsul Quran. These are confirmed facts. And yet, because of government pressure, people are saying they are brothers, the Ja'fariya, and the only difference between us and them is in fiqh, which is far from the truth. Our difference is in usul. They believe, some of them, that Sayyiduna Ali Karamullah Wajhul Kareem is more afdal, more superior to Sayyiduna, to all the Anbiya alayhi salatu wassalam. And this is kufr. To believe Sayyiduna Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu an is afdal al-bashar is the ijma' of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. But if someone believes otherwise, it is not kufr. The person does not become a kafir. But if he believes someone is more afdal than all the Anbiya alayhimus salatu wassalam, he becomes a kafir. They make the exception for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Diobandis placed a last page at the end. They wrote, Ahmad Raza Khan Sahab Brelvi ki ilmi diyanat ka ek namuna. And they placed the passage which Al-Imam Ahmad Raza Khan quoted. And they say, look, he placed three different sentences and made this one passage and gave this to the ulama. But in reality, they are three different sentences. Fair enough. They are three different sentences, but I will tell you what. If you take each sentence separately, each sentence alone becomes one kufr. So it does not end up being one kufr, it ends up being three kufrs. Listen to the statements. Statement number one. بلکہ اگر بالفرد آپ کے زمانے میں بھی کہیں اور نبی ہو جب بھی آپ کا خاتم ہونا بدستور باقی رہتا ہے. Page 18. That if supposedly after his time, meaning the Messenger صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم, another prophet comes, him being خاتم النبیین, the final prophet, he will still remain. Meaning that even if another prophet comes, he is still Khatamun Nabiyyin. This is one kufr. To believe that if another prophet comes, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam still remains Khatamun Nabiyyin is denying the tawatur and the ijma' and the Qur'an. And then, balke, that's page 18. So this is their own. Balke agar bil fard ba'd zamana nabawi. And he doesn't write sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he writes sad, lam, ayn, meem. And our ulama have mentioned to write abbreviations for salawat is haram. You should write sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, complete. So some people now, they deny this. Even one person who was promoting these cover maulid, he wrote S after writing the name of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the brothers then told me and he said he's not believing me that the fatwa is that it is wajib to write sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we phoned him and he still did not believe us. But here he says, agar bil fard ba'd zamana nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bhi koi nabi paida ho to phir bhi khatamiyat muhammadi mein kuch fark na aayega. That if supposedly after the prophetic time another prophet is born, then the khatamiyat, meaning the finality of the Muhammadi finality, it would not affect that in any way or form. This is second sentence. Then the third statement, awam ke khayal mein to Rasulullah, again sad lam ayn meem, sallallahu alayhi wasallam ka khatam hona by maana hai ke aapka zamana e anbiya sabiq ke zamana ke baad وہ آپ کے سب میں آخری نبی ہے مگر اہل فہم پر روشن ہوگا کہ تقدم یا تأخر زمانے میں بذات کچھ فضیلت نہیں. The translation of this, the common people think that the finality of the prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم would come in the meaning that you, in terms of time, are the last of the prophets compared to the previous prophets, and you are the last prophet, meaning in time. This is the, he says, this is the commoner's belief. When, in fact, the ijma' of the ummah is that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is khatamun nabiyyin with time as well. He's the last of prophets to be sent in time. But he states, magar ahle fahm, but on the people of understanding, meaning himself and his sect, par roshan hoga, it will be enlightened for them, ke taqaddum ya ta'akhur, previous or coming late, zamane mein bhi zaat kuch fazilat nahi, there's no virtue in whether someone comes first or comes at the end. There's no virtue in this according to him. And this was the so-called tahqiq that he presented, and he came out with innovative speech, bid'ah. And we looked at the statement of Imam Abdul Wahhab Sha'rani, rahimahullah ta'ala, at the beginning, that do not say things in his ahud al-madhmuma, that do not say things which no one has said prior to you. Do not oppose the book of Allah, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the ijma'. But the Diobandis will eat this hook, line and sinker and accept its research as valid research. And now we are being told to accept this man as a Muslim, and not only a Muslim, a person from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Mind you, the Qadiyaniya also, the title they use for him is Hujjatul Islam. The title they use for him is Hujjatul Islam. We know this is the title of Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah ta'ala. The not only as accepting as a valid scholar, but also a scholar of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. People want us to accept this. We must say that if we want unity, we must give up these type of beliefs. Then we will have unity of the ummah. And we need to stop promoting our agendas. And this is where I finish with this last book of one of my favorite authors, Shaykh Yusuf bin Ismail al-Nabahani, rahimahullah ta'ala. Sabil al-Najati fil hubbi fi Allah wal-bughdi fi Allah. That the way of salvation in love for Allah and hatred for Allah. Nowadays, when these maulid gatherings are done, these undercover maulid gatherings, and I call them undercover because they have an agenda. When these maulid gatherings are carried out, people emphasize al-hub fillah, love for Allah, but they never emphasize al-bughd fillah, hatred for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll find them loving disbelievers, kuffar. You'll find them loving Ahlul Bid'ah, people of innovation of Bid'ah Mukaffira. And you will find them loving the callers to innovation. I thought it is necessary to mention the rulings of Ahlul Bid'ah as laid out by Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabahani, rahimahullah ta'ala. He has the last chapter, Bayanul Ladina Yubghaduna Fillah, chapter on those who are disliked for the sake of Allah, wa kayfiyatu mu'amalatihim, and how you should deal with them. Wa hum ala aqsamin, there are many types. There are many types. The first, al qism al awwal al kafir. The first one is kafir. First one is kafir. Now, recently, one of the individuals, a few years ago, in fact, after the Danish cartoons happened, he said, he criticized the ulama for not doing dua for the Pope. For not doing dua for the Pope. And after he criticized the ulama, I done my speech last year where I mentioned names also. And one of his representatives came to see us, a group of brothers, and there were over 20 people in the room. And we said to him that it has been reported from trustworthy people who were witnesses that the scholar that you follow condemned the Muslim ulama for not praying for the Pope. Can you confirm this? He confirmed it, and he affirmed this as a valid position, that you can pray for the Christians after they pass away. After they die, you can pray for the Christians. We told him that we believe that this position is kufr, even though we do not do takfir of you and your sheikh. We believe the position is kufr. We leave the takfir, the fatwa, for the muftiyan. He left that gathering and he's told people that these people are doing takfir of me and other people. He spread rumors. And the people he told came back and confirmed, and we told them that we did not do takfir, and there were over 20 people in the room. This same person took government funding where they spent over £70,000 in 3 days on two scholars which they took to another country. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best where they get their money from. We know where the Saudi Salafis get their money from, oil money. And we know where the peers get their money from the Muridun. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best where these people are being funded from. While our jama'ah, we have to carry books by hand and carrier bags, sometimes walk distances. When I bought Al-Fatawa Ridwiya, I had to walk 2 miles with the book because I did not have a car. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserves our jama'ah. We are masakeen at the doors of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And people will criticize us and continue criticizing us for standing up for this issue because they love those personalities. And I cannot do anything if you love personalities who hold these beliefs. You must look at this objectively. And if anyone wants to correct me, they can come and meet me. I'm very approachable. We're not very difficult to approach. You can meet me at Taj Dari Medina Masjid, where I hold Durus, 7 o'clock every evening. And many people have my phone number. They can phone me direct. And people can meet me on the road as well when I walk. They're very approachable people, alhamdulillah. We do not have groups around us whisking us away to the car, and you will not see me after the speech. No, very approachable, inshallah. And the same goes for Sayyidi Irfan Shah Mashadi, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, who is defending the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah in the English language against the Rawafid and other people of Bid'ah. He says, Al-Qismul Awwalu Al-Kafir, the first person is the Kafir. And the Kafir divides into two types. وَهُوَ إِنْ كَانَ مُحَارِبًا يَسْتَحِقُ الْقَتْلَ وَالْإِرْقَاقِ If he is a warmonger, then he must deserve killing and being enslaved. And this is done by the ruler. We are not endorsing vigilante attacks. I make this very clear. We are not endorsing vigilante attacks. This is referring to the ruler. The ruler must fight the disbelievers and enslave them. And now this new tahqiq someone has done regarding offensive jihad and defensive jihad, and saying that the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do any offensive jihad, just to fit in this modern agenda which I am talking about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from fitan, from tribulation. وَلَيْسَ بَعْدَ هَذَيْنِ إِهَانَةٌ And after these two, meaning killing and enslaving them, there is nothing more despicable. Then a dhimmi. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَجُوزُ إِذَاءُ We can never harm Ahlul Dhimma, people who have taken a protection under the Muslim ruler. If non-Muslim minorities must be safe in a Muslim country. But, he says, لَا يَجُوزُ إِذَاءُ إِلَّا بِالْإِعْرَاضِ عَنْهُ You must not mix with them. Look, وَنَحْوِ ذَلِكَ والأولى الكف عن مخالطته ومعاملته ومواكلته. He goes, it is better to avoid mixing with Ahlul Dhimma and dealing with them and deputizing them for things. People who are minorities in Muslim lands. So think about the non-Muslim who lives in Darul Harb. Now Muslims are living as a minority here, are being made to mix in with this society to water down Islam. I prefer Muslim communities being isolated. Why? Because it keeps that essence of Islam. And isolation does not mean that we are rude and ill-mannered and we want to kill people. No, we want to preserve our way of life. If they can have a Chinatown, we can also have a Muslim town. Muslim areas are something we must promote and keep our dignity for our women, so they do not work with non-Muslim men and mix with them and lose the ghayra. If people lose their ghayra, if they're eating riba, and buying homes and mortgages, riba-based, interest-based mortgages, they are losing their ghayra. They're losing their decency. Decency in the deen and the decency in the dunya. Then, Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabahani mentions al-qism al-thani al-mubtadi', the innovator. And he says, وَهُوَ إِمَّا يَكُونَ دَاعِيًا إِلَى بِدْعَتِي أَوْ يَكُونَ مِنْ عَوَامِ النَّاسِ. Either he is one of the callers to innovation, like this man, Usama Hassan. Recently, he's the one who translated Sifatu Salatin Nabi of Nasiruddin al-Albani. And after having translated that, later he became a modernist. He mixes with some of these premier-list backers and people who do maulid. Those who are claiming that they are Ash'ari. And now he has openly said in The Guardian, which he writes for, that Muslims should be more accepting for the theory of evolution. Do you see how everything is interlinked? If people do not uphold the honor of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will never stand up for anything else. So, he says, either he is a caller to his innovation or he is from the common people. If he is a caller to innovation, then he is worse than a kafir in his danger to al-Islam. Because with the kafir, you are aware of his danger. And with this person, he claims to be a Muslim and he has breached the ranks of the Muslims and he preaches his innovation. Then Al-Imam Yusuf al-Nabahani rahmallahu ta'ala mentions the commoner. He says, as for the commoner innovator, then we must not be harsh to him, the commoner. And we must try winning him over. We must try winning him over with love. But once everything becomes clear to him, then we must leave him. Then we must leave him. But we must win these people, the commoners, the common masses, with love. And the third grouping is sinful Muslims. The ruling on them is light. We must show love to them to bring them to practice because they do not have innovation. Then he has a chapter called Tanbih, a warning. And these are extracted from the Ihya Ulum al-Din of Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala. In this he says that students of knowledge and common Muslims should not attend the gatherings of innovators. They should never attend the gatherings of innovators, common Muslims and the students of knowledge. He mentions that for the ulama who are mutamakkinun, grasp in their sciences, meaning have deep understanding, they can attend the gathering of Ahlul Bid'ah in order to correct the Ahlul Bid'ah. But the commoners should not attend. So if we see a valid sheikh going to a gathering, which is the gathering of innovators, we should have good thought of him, but we should not attend ourselves. We should not attend ourselves. Then it is the responsibility of that scholar to correct the innovators. It is the responsibility of that scholar to correct the innovators. But that is only allowed for al-ulama al-rasikhun, well-versed ulama. As for students of knowledge and the common Muslims, they should not attend the gatherings of the people of innovation. And this is the conclusion of my talk. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم وأتوب إليه. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى that he makes this for his sake and not for the sake of attacking people or for personal gains, because I will not gain anything from this except reward inshallah in the hereafter. والحمد لله رب العالمين.